Well, I wonder if Ustream is going to work now. Well, I think it may be working now, but who knows? Those of you on Ustream, I'm broadcasting to Ustream from my iPhone, and it may quit. If it does, please go to portlandinsight.org and look on the in the boxes, and you'll see it's offerings from PIMC online, and go and look for the Zoom link for Sunday morning. Oh, well. Oh, now it's working. Okay. So, dear folks on... All right. Hello, Bill. To those of you on Ustream, if... I'm broadcasting using my iPhone. And we're working on the camera, getting it to work properly again. But I don't... If this should quit, the Ustream... Zip over to portlandinsight.org. Oh, and navigate to where it has the links for all the online offerings. And you can find me there on the Sunday link, which I didn't know to go to just until moments ago. Taking a moment to land. I had a poem. I had a poem. What was it? Let me see chat. So those of you that are not on Zoom, if you want to switch to Zoom, zoom.us/j/72550473, but you had to have your pencil ready. So please go to the website and find us that way if the Ustream quits. All right. I had a poem prepared. It's from the time of the Buddha, from Lao Tzu, Chinese origin. Why scurry about looking for the truth? It vibrates in everything and every not thing, right off the tip of your nose. Can you be still and see it in the mountain, the pine tree, yourself? Don't imagine that you'll discover it by accumulating more knowledge. Knowledge creates doubt, and doubt makes you ravenous for more knowledge. You can never get full eating this way. The wise person dines on something more subtle. She eats the understanding that the named was born from the unnamed, that all being flows from non-being, and that the describable world emanates from an indescribable source. He finds this subtle truth inside his own self and becomes completely content. So who can be still and watch the chess game of the world? The foolish are always making impulsive moves, but the wise know that victory and defeat are decided by something more subtle. They see that something perfect exists before any move is made. This subtle perfection deteriorates when artificial actions are taken, So be content not to disturb the peace. Remain quiet. Discover the harmony in your own being. Embrace it. If you can do this, you will gain everything and the world will become healthy again. If you can't, you will be lost in the shadows forever. Don't imagine that you'll discover it by accumulating more knowledge. Knowledge creates doubt, and doubt makes you ravenous for more knowledge. You can't get full eating this way. The wise person dines on something more subtle. He eats the understanding that the named was born from the unnamed, and that all being flows from non-being, and that the describable world emanates from an indescribable source. She finds this subtle truth inside her own self and becomes completely content. So who can be still and watch the chess game of the world? The foolish are always making impulsive moves, but the wise know that victory and defeat are decided by something more subtle. They see that something perfect exists before any move is made. Remain quiet. Discover the harmony in your own being and embrace it. Well, hardly enough room to turn around in here. Awkward, but it's working. Refuge in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. Join in this makes sense for you. I take refuge in the Buddha, the one who shows me the way in this life. Namo Buddhaya, Namo Buddhaya, Namo Buddhaya. I take refuge in the Sangha, the community of mindful harmony. Namo Sanghaya Dharmaya. I got it wrong. Namo Dharmaya. Namo Dharmaya. Now, Sangha. I take refuge in the Sangha, the community of mindful harmony. Namo Sanghaya. Namo Sanghaya. Namo Sanghaya. Well, there was lots of wandering mind there. Before I had to shut my computer down, I had a lovely picture of the community in practice at PIMC that I was going to switch to now, and to speak about the impermanence of this circumstance with COVID-19, that before long, we don't know how long, but before long we'll be having a grand opening party, and we'll be back in our lovely Dharma Center. It's still there. I was there yesterday. And it's still just as beautiful. It's cold, though. Boy, oh boy. So, Let's stop and sit for a while. I could use that. If your eyes happen to be open, take a moment to look around your surroundings and be aware of seeing. Seeing. And then bring the eyes to the center and let them be a little downcast. And then let them close and notice how seeing disappears. And we land when we awaken. We land in the body. We notice this breathing in and breathing out of the breath. We can notice the contact of the body with the chair, the cushion, the floor. Receiving the aliveness and noticing there is that which is aware, and there are the objects of awareness. And a question arises, which is, how intimately can this awareness embrace the objects of awareness? If awareness opens in the lower half of the body, in the thighs and knees and feet and calves. And there's no need to look down from up behind the eyes, because awareness isn't localized there, is it? Awareness is non-local. Inviting awareness to come alive in the hands and fingers, in the face, and there is this living miracle of the breath. Where we take in oxygen, which is then marvelously spread throughout the whole body to every cell, by the lungs and the heart and the arteries. And then we breathe out the carbon dioxide that we don't need, but is needed at least in some supply by our green friends. They're getting a bit much these days. But still, we breathe because we belong, because we are part of the earth. Embracing this aliveness. Embracing with warm-hearted, compassionate awareness also whatever emotional state is present. Pushing away emotions doesn't get rid of them. It just pushes them back in to pop up into the unconscious, to pop up somewhere else, another moment. And receiving also all the content of the wandering mind, the past and future, the worries, the plans, the desires, the disliking, the liking, all the opinions. And so when you can, abide gently, lovingly in the breath. And if delight arises, don't hesitate to inhabit delight. Allowing everything to be just exactly as it is. Each breath has its beginning. Each breath has its birth. It comes out of emptiness, out of non-being. And then it very much exists for a little while. And then it disappears. So not only are we paying attention to the actual sensations of breathing, we are noticing their quality of anicca, of not permanence. And the same when the mind wanders, it too is anicca. Sometimes meditators find it helpful to use little mental notes like rising, rising, falling, falling, wandering, wandering, returning, returning, or a mantra on the in-breath, Calm body on the out-breath, calm mind. Or on the in-breath, may I be happy. On the out-breath, may all beings be happy. So we use these to enhance awareness and also to enhance concentration. If you have some mala beads, you can also use them. Rising, rising, falling, falling, bead with your fingers. Or may I be happy, may all beings be happy, bead with your fingers. And we can remind ourselves of a familiar teaching from Achan Cha. Anytime we wish to bring our practice into perfect balance, remember this moment is like this. It's really like this right now. Perhaps it's a moment of great ease and the breath rises and falls. There's a little wandering mind. It's obvious that phenomena are dancing into being in consciousness and then disappearing. Or perhaps it's difficult to even find the breath. There's so much emotion, anxiety, fear. There's so much wanting or not wanting. This is a mind in restlessness. It's like this. And while the self, the experience of the self in the world does improve with meditation, mostly, that's not the purpose, not the fundamental goal. The fundamental goal is awakening to what is. So noticing this present moment is like this. Satipatthana Vipassana. Mindfulness training. Training the mind, the heart mind, to perceive reality as it is. Deconstructing the experience of the self. Setting ourselves free from identification with thoughts and emotions, and ultimately even the body. Recognizing our interbeing and interconnection with all of life, and particularly with each other. Insight meditation. Insight into the truths of impermanence, dukkha, unsatisfactoriness, and anatta, the fact that the self, this that we experience as I, me, and mine, is actually a process. No enduring entity. One pole of the great paradox, anicca. And let's incline the heart in a different direction now. Maybe take a moment to adjust your posture so you feel comfortable. And this is an imagination practice, a practice of the heart. Please know that where you are is about as safe as a human being can be. And rest there. Let yourself really rest and relax. And I'm going to invite you to imagine that you are at a familiar place, or maybe an imagined place in the forest. It's a beautiful sunny day in a little clearing. Or maybe you're in a familiar old place in a rocking chair, going back and forth and back and forth. And you feel perfectly safe. Or maybe for you it's the beach. There's a slight breeze and the sun is warm and you have a little shade. The surf is roaring quietly in the background and there are seagulls. And again, you feel very safe. And whatever the case, in wherever we go with this, you can know that this voice will go with you, and you can always come back to your safe spot in the woods or the rocker or at the beach or wherever you would like it to be. And in this world that you enter, you look around and you discover that there's a little trail. And it's a trail that heads off into a light forest. It's a forest like here in the Northwest, but it also has deciduous trees, and the sun sometimes slants down onto the trail. But it's a very intriguing trail. And you realize that it's safe to leave your backpack and everything here, and you can travel this trail very lightly. And knowing that everything will be safe there, you set off on this trail through the forest. And it has that beautiful summer forest smell, where the trail is hot in places and smells like pine trees, Doug firs. And some people do visualizations very easily. For others, it's not so easy. It's just as well, though. Works just as well, fine. Just imagine the warm feeling in your heart and a kindness toward yourself and all beings as you walk along this trail. And you walk along and keep climbing a little bit. You step over roots and rocks. And that feeling of safety and comfort is continuing. And as you rise through the forest to higher levels, you discover that ahead of you, the trees are thinning, and it looks like a clearing. And you get there and you discover that in fact it is a clearing on an exquisitely beautiful valley. And there's a lake in the valley and hillsides on either side. And you walk out into the clearing and down toward the lake and you discover that there's a flat rock. And it's really a very attractive rock. There's moss on it even. And you go and you settle yourself in there. And your heart feels so full and open. You feel connected with everything that lives as you look out over the lake and the hills on either side. In great distance is visible for you. And something prompts you to look over to your right. And you see that there's a person. There's a person coming out of the trees. And for some of us, that might be the Buddha or Kuan Yin. And it could be anybody. It could be anybody who really you have loved in your lifetime and who you know loves you. It could be someone who's alive still or someone who has passed on. And they come out of the woods and walk toward you with a big smile on their face, and it's such a sense of recognition and homecoming. And in this world, there's no coronavirus, so you can hug them freely when they get there. And then you sit down together. And they suggest that you begin radiating love out over the lake. Love into the hills around you, love into the mountains behind them. Love to the birds and the fish, to your friends, colleagues, families. And you might imagine this is golden or white light or simply the intention, a subtle vibration out into the world. And once again, you look toward the perimeter of this clearing and you discover that someone else is coming out. Another person whom you love or has loved you very much in this lifetime. And they come and join the two of you. Very sweet, warm greetings. And then they too know this is the place for training the heart, for engaging the heart in opening to love and compassion for all beings. And so you sit together. Your sangha is building and yet another person comes out. And then another. And perhaps a favorite pet from childhood comes out. And you know who your most beloveds are, so allow them to join you. And the rock seems big enough to fit everyone who comes. At first there's excitement, and then it quickly settles down into wishing may all beings everywhere be protected and free from fear and danger. May all beings be healthy. May all beings have enough to eat. May all beings awaken to their true great nature. And what would be your prayer or wish? Recognizing that you are connected to the absolute heart of the universe, you are that. Letting your body become a radiator out into the world of loving energy. And you can sit here for a short time or a long time, or just as long as you want to, basking in this community of wishing well-being to all beings. If you have any resentments towards anyone, love those resentments and that person as well. You're safe here. You can relax. Extending love over the lake, over the hills, over the mountains, all around the planet. To those members of our family who swim in the oceans and the lakes, those who fly in the sky, those who walk on the land. Wishing all beings well, with the support of the Buddha or Kuan Yin or all these other friends and family sitting beside you. And knowing that you can come back here anytime you want, this is your place. For now, thanking everyone for coming. And then one by one, they bow to you. They say, I'll see you whenever you want. And they make their way off into the woods, one by one. Until finally it's you and Kuan Yin or the Buddha or Mary or Jesus or whoever it is. And you look deeply into one another's eyes with complete and absolute confidence and knowing. The way home is through love. The way home is through compassion. And that in life, in the words of Ram Dass, our task is to walk each other home. And you watch as this archetypal figure, the Buddha, Kuan Yin, rises, you bow to each other, and they head off into the woods, no hurry. And you too, taking in this lake and really getting its coordinates clear in your heart so you can come back here anytime. And a part of you might reside here all the time. And then you get up from your sitting spot and bow to the lake, bow to all beings. Find your way back to the edge of the forest and take one last sweet look at this lake. Such beauty now with the sun glinting off it and perhaps that incredible, almost blinding brilliance of waves being reflected by the sun. And finding your way into the forest and down and down and down and over roots and rocks. And every trail always looks like a new trail going the other way. And carrying with you the ease and the beauty and the knowledge of love and compassion. And find your way back till you discover the rock in the little meadow where your backpack is sitting, or you find yourself rocking back and forth in that rocker, in that comfortable space. Or maybe to the beach where everything is exactly where you left it. And you can see the ocean and the birds are passing by and making their bird sounds. And so we find ourselves now remembering that there's a body sitting here. It sits and breathes. It has a marvelous imagination. It has profound within it, profound capacities of awareness and love and compassion that need just the slightest encouragement to develop more and more. As we each sit right here on the very edge, the leading edge of consciousness evolution on the earth, we are all part of what Joanna Macy calls the Great Turning. The movement toward awakening to our utter interbeing, to the fact that we are utterly connected. And that the way to live successfully on the earth is to care for each other, to treat each other as what we are, which is other manifestations of the same energy, the same consciousness. Seeing everyone as yourself. And so we breathe in and we breathe out. In and out. And from this place of locality, location in the body, feel your way out into our little group here, gathering over the internet. In, at one level, at one tuning, we're far apart. At another, there is no separation between us at all. And so we wish one another well. May you be happy. May you be free from fear and danger. May you take good care of yourself in this time and wash your hands a lot and don't touch your face. And find ways that you can to be kind and loving to others. Because it's the only game in town, really, learning to love each other. And so now, noticing your body sitting here, it's been quite a while. It may want to move. There may be stiffnesses. So without opening your eyes yet, I invite you to let whatever movement wants to happen begin, but let it go real slowly. We're not going anywhere. It's just this sitting here belonging to each other. And not rushing off somewhere, here it is, this body sitting, stretching. And in honor of Ruth Denison, the great pioneer in Dharma, leaving eyes closed, please let your left ear become magnetized toward your left shoulder and let the head slowly drop over that way, but very slowly. No hurry. And then very gently, slowly rising up to the center and over. So the right ear and right shoulder are drawn, leaving the shoulder loose. Feel where the stiffness is in the neck. Let yourself breathe in and out deeply. Mindfulness of posture and stretching. Once again, letting the head come to the top and then slowly the left ear falls toward the left shoulder. Let your breathing continue. And once again, up to the top and over to the right. And then letting your head ever so slowly loll itself forward, keeping your back straight. Feeling the movement and the sensations. Until eventually you come so you have your left shoulder and ear and letting it go back now, being very gentle and aware and careful of what you're doing. All the way around to the other side, and then back. Do you discover impatience? What's more important than this moment of allowing your neck to get some of the stretching it really longs for? And letting now your hands rise up. My fingers happen to be interlaced. Let them rise up in front of you and stretch up toward the sky. And then let any stretching that would like to happen in this sitting, reaching up posture happen. And then let your whole upper body move in any way you'd like, aware of the many sensations that are there. And then when you're ready, notice the intention to open your eyes. And then let the eyes open. And you'll be seeing. Seeing and knowing it. In my instance, there you all are. There are little pictures of you. Seeing. Now there's a few. Oh, it's so nice to see you. What a pleasure. I wonder, can you zip through the different displays and see each other too? I think you can. If you're on, what's it called? Not speaker view, but the other. Yeah. All right, there's a few things that I want to say. I'm still coming back from the lake. Thank you for your patience with all the broadcast. Doyle just sent me a message. It's called Gallery View. Hello, Doyle Banks, you lovely man. I have a few announcements. One is this. There are some classes coming that, before that, if you're not on the listserv or the conscious, my neighbor is quite close here. I hope he doesn't make a lot of noise. What's it called? Continuous contact? No, it's called constant contact. I suggest you put yourself on that list, which you can do on the PortlandInsight.org website, and that way you'll get the announcements. You can also join the listserv, which is called Connections there. And if you do either of those, you will get the weekly digest, which Gregory and Molly are doing such a great job on. And on the weekly digest, you'll get this. I'm suggesting you hold the dates. Starting Wednesday, April 22nd, I'm doing a class on the Dhammapada. It's an 8-week class, and the Dhammapada is really the most beloved of the Buddha's teachings. It's a distillation of them, and it's been translated into countless languages, and a marvelous book. And we'll read it and discuss it online here. Gary Sanders is doing the Four Foundations of Mindfulness class. And that starts where, you can look it up on the website and on the digest. And Doug Pullen is doing an introduction to heart cultivation, the Buddha's teaching on the divine abodes. And then, Doyle, are you there? Can you come on? I have your okay, why don't you come on here? Can you unmute yourself?
Hi, Robert. Hi, everyone.
Hi, I wanted you to just speak of the offerings you're doing soon. Go ahead.
Tomorrow night is called Open for Empathy. It will start at 7 o'clock and go for a couple of hours. If you've not signed up yet and want to participate, send me an email at doyle@doylebanks.com and I'll get you the information for that, doyle@doylebanks.com. And it'll basically be just time for people to share what's on their hearts and minds in a caring and compassionate circle.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Saturday, April 4th, live stream retreat. The first Saturday monthly day-long retreat with Jim Dalton. There's an NVC practice group on the 14th and another retreat, Qigong with Jim, on the 18th. Okay, I think that's it. Liz Ullman sent me a text or email just before I came on. Some people are concerned about losing their health insurance with with their jobs. To those of you in Canada, this is a particularly American phenomenon. We're very primitive here around health insurance. You could, well, if you're laid off or fired, you could probably qualify at healthinsurance.org/Oregon. All right. Just a few things I wanted to say. Well... Thank you for hanging in here through all the glitches.
Robert, I just sent out a invitation to the Monday night Jim's Guest House connection with PIMC.
Oh, good. Thank you, Jim.
Tomorrow at 7 p.m. Thank you.
Right. Yeah, there's a lot happening. Thank you for reminding me. There's that, and then Gary is on Tuesday nights, and Gregory on Wednesdays, and I'm teaching doing a guided meditation every morning at 7, and that's all on the website. All right. I'm aware of this time that we're having now. It's in a way like a retreat. We can make it more and more like a retreat if we want, by taking more time to be reflective. And there are many things we can't do, many of our distractions that we would normally be doing. And by not doing them, we're forced to face some parts of ourselves and some parts of life that otherwise we wouldn't encounter. And that's true in spades when one goes on a retreat. Because the usual distractions aren't there, and to the degree one is willing to contain oneself into the structure of the retreat, then we get a chance to observe parts of life and ourselves that we otherwise would never see. And it's so not the direction of our culture. Instead of having an impulse to do something and doing it, it's, well, I'm going to continue to sit here and I'm going to study the impulse. I'm going to study the part of myself that gets angry or sad or freaked out because I can't have what I want. I talked to my daughter Tara last night. She's working at Providence, Portland, and she's not on the COVID floor yet. But she said that there's a lot of anger with people because, for instance, patients can only have one visitor. Has to be the same visitor, if they're allowed a visitor at all. And the family members show up wanting to come in and they're not allowed. And so then there's lots of anger. It's like, I want this. It's a very important thing to me to be with my loved one. And they're not allowed to. And so the staff face this kind of barrage of hurt, angry people on top of all the other stuff that the people are going through, the patients are going through. And I was in the hospital a lot back the last several months. And it was so nice to have loved ones with me. I had somebody stay with me overnight most nights. But it's very limited now, and it's creating strong emotions. And this time of social isolation, social distancing, is probably, I know I've talked to many people, is doing the same thing with us. And it's putting some heat into relationships and difficulties with children. And I feel so sorry for people who are used to sending their kids off to school and then the kids are home. We have a little bit of that. Our kids are a lot older. I have an 18-year-old stepdaughter and a 15-year-old stepson, and they're wonderful kids. And they're struggling to not go out and be with their friends. And so it brings up what's unfinished inside them. So emotions. I wanted to talk about emotions in this context. How to work with emotions. I'm going to I'm going to portray it as if it were happening in meditation because it's the cleanest and simplest then. I'm sitting here and I'm feeling anxious. I'm feeling frightened. I'm worried about what's going to happen to mother, father, brother, sister, other relations who are in another city. And I was reading this morning an article about the tremendous fear that we have of dying alone or having our loved ones die alone. And that is happening. It's happening that family members can't be with the person who's dying of COVID. But of course, the nurses and the doctors and the people in the hospital are filling that in. They're really going out of their way to be with people as they die. But anyway, I'm back here on my cushion and I'm feeling anxious. So I'm using my breath to stabilize. Here I am, I'm concentrating with the breath. And maybe I can use the breath to suppress the anxiety, and maybe I can find my way into a place of great ease. If you can do that, why not? Why not have half an hour a day or an hour a day of simple ease where you're not thinking about anything at all? Now, that takes dedication, of course, but it's quite possible. But let's say it is happening. Let's say there's anxiety happening or anger or sadness or hopelessness. This moment is like this. What's the mental state? I'm curious. What's this mental state that's so heavy or painful? So we turn toward the mind and toward the body and we ask, where do I experience this? What is this? And this is pretty hard to do sometimes because these are usually feelings we don't want to feel, or they're ego dystonic. It's like, I don't feel that. Well, maybe I do feel that. And we turn toward it and open to it, and where do I feel it in the body, and how utterly intimate can I be with this emotion? Now, that's hard work. How dare I feel how anxious I am? Dare I feel how lonely I really feel? Or dare I feel, on the other pole, dare I feel how much love there is in my heart? Dare I feel how remarkably compassionate I am? Because in this time, as we experience some things of the more challenging, unpleasant side, we may also experience openings on the very positive side that are new to us. That we can use this time as a time of awakening in that way. So we awaken to accept the challenging emotions, and we also awaken to accept the blessing of the Dharma awakening in our hearts. So I'm sitting and I feel that, and sometimes it'll get stronger, the emotion will get stronger. Sometimes it would move to tears or other expression. Sometimes it might move to bliss or the body tingling and vibrating. Whatever it does, we simply abide with that. To spend the time that we have, that we grant ourselves to open up into the reality of this moment. And this all happens in the context of anicca, impermanence, that if we look closely, we'll see that these emotions are actually not what we think they are. They are experiences, they're sensations in the body, they're a flow through of energy, and none of them are lasting, nor are they personal. That's the anatta. They are phenomena occurring within this organism, within this being that we take to be ourselves. And then one last thing with this, which is, pandemics are not new. This isn't the last pandemic. Most of us, 99% of us, will come through this and survive. Some of us will come through this and have had our hearts open stunningly. Our relationship to the world will be changed because we'll have used this time to experience our interbeing with all of life and our profound connection with each other. And we're so fortunate to have this Zoom and the Ustream, because we can remind ourselves of our connection with each other, and we can experience in this limited but still pretty remarkable way. Okay, and PIMC depends upon your financial support. And there's very easy ways, if you go on the website and look, there's very easy ways to click links and make contributions. However, please don't make any contributions until Monday night. We had a fraud thing happen on our account and had a check, fraudulently changed the amount. And so we had to close that account, and we're waiting for that to come online. So if you can hold yourself back from making your contributions, please hold back till Monday night. By then we should have it operational. So I want to open up to our Zoom world here, and I will do my best. My apologies to those of you on, there's so many acronyms, aren't there? Ustream. I hope you can hear what people say. And so I'm going to look on Zoom and see, does anybody want to speak? Oh, someone writes and says to me, I donated before you said to wait. I hope it's okay. I don't know what will happen with that. Maybe see what happens in your checkbook. But man, maybe we'll send you a notice that it failed. So, anybody else? Anybody have something you'd like to share about this social isolation time? Or anything else?
Hey, Robert, this is Vic here. Can you hear me?
I can. I'm going to look for... Oh, I know. I'm going to change the view, speaker view. There you are. Hi.
Hi there.
Vic and Anne-Marie. Hi.
Well, first of all, Robert, thank you so much for organizing these Zoom meetings. I mean, you guys have done this without missing a beat, and it's been so helpful. So a lot of gratitude. Thank you.
And we did it without any tension or effort. It was just like that.
Yeah. The second thing I wanted to say was, there's a lot of... other mentality that's happening right now, where in a sense saying this is the Chinese virus. This is happening because red states are not isolating as much. And there's this tendency for us to kind of do more of the other at this point. But one of the things that strikes me right now is this is actually an amazing time to reflect about our connection, because the viruses would not be able to jump from species to species if we were not compatible. If we did not run the same operating system, the viruses would not be able to jump from species to species. So I think it actually is a really interesting reminder of the fact that we're all running the same operating system and we are compatible. And I just thought that was an interesting thought.
I do too. And it's a it's communicated through respiration, this breath that we if we didn't all share the same air, it wouldn't have a chance, but we do. Thank you, Vic. Opening up for anybody else who would like to. Please unmute yourself and speak. That'd probably be the easiest way for this to.
Hey, Robert, it's Tamara.
Where? I'm going to go back. Oh, hello, Tamara.
I'm not on video. I'm not a big fan. I do lots of Zoom meetings with my work, and I hate the videos.
So. Okay. I know you just didn't get out of your pajamas. That's your excuse.
I'm not. And so that's really why I hate it. Didn't even do my hair, nothing. So,
right.
My interesting thing I noticed is I am really busy with making plans all the time. And anybody, you know, I've been told through my life, like, you're always gone or you're always busy or you can't, you know, and to me, it's such a norm. And that has really become just forefront in my day because I wake up making plans for the day. And then I find myself midday making plans for the evening. And then late at night making plans. You know, like there's always something's got to be in the works. And this waking up in the middle of the day, having that planning coming up and realizing, nope, can't do that. Nope, can't do that. Nope, can't do that. And my day just gets stripped down to, there's nothing you can do here except for these couple few things that you've been doing every day and being okay with that and also not losing like my practice because my routine isn't there. You know, my routine of going to PMIC or not doing some yoga because I can't go to that class I always go to or whatever it is. It's just been interesting to watch these, you know, becoming more mindful of that I do am constantly trying to fill my day with things and not just letting myself be, and that I can still do things that support me even though I can't do them the same way that I normally do them, and that's really been kind of tricky for me.
Thank you, Tamara. Anybody else? Here we go.
Hi, Robert. Can you hear me?
I can. I can't see. I'm going to go to speaker view. Oh, there you go. Hi. Hey. Emily.
Hello. I just want to say thanks for the guided lake.
Oh. Thing.
That was great. I feel like I haven't had that level of peace in a while in the meditation practice. And I got to see some old pets, which I hadn't even thought about the old childhood pets. And that brought a little tear to my eyes. So, it was just nice to be in that space for a moment and be reminded of, I don't know, natural spaces. And
thank you to the Tibetans for that practice.
Yeah, thank you for sharing.
Anybody else? Is that I can't tell.
Hey, Robert.
Hello.
Gary and Alex.
Hang on here. Let me get the. Oh, hi. It's Gary. Yeah, hi. Oh, look at that. You have a panda bear around your neck.
Yeah. She's got a sore neck. It's something that you can heat up.
And, oh, cool.
Yeah. Alex is not moving her neck with everybody today. I have to say that I love Lori's cat right now. Her cat is like right in front of the camera and it's kneading bread.
Ah, really?
And we have over the last couple of weeks, you know, we've been in a ton of different Zoom meetings, whether it's you know, other, and it's been such a great opportunity. I've sat with, and we together have sat with Kevin Griffin, Vinny Ferraro. We did a day long with Locke Kelly yesterday, and Jim was on the call as well. It's so great to be able to take advantage of these teachings that are so freely available now virtually. You know, we don't have to go anywhere. We just need to turn on a computer.
Right.
And then these little extra bonuses like Lori's cat. I've seen so many dogs and cats over the last couple of weeks.
Huh.
And there's a mixture of mudita. I love these animals, and I've had, you know, during the meditation, I thought of my early cats, Bunny and Silky, and they play and fetch with them, and you know, snuggle cats. So there's all this mudita and appreciation that comes up, and then there's like a little bit of jealousy too, to be honest. We have a cat that is great and he's fun, but he doesn't sit on our lap.
Uh-huh.
And he's not a snuggle cat. He loves me to chase him around. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's that a little bit of longing, you know, mm-hmm. and maybe that's because we've been holed up, you know, voluntarily. We've been holed up for about a month now, you know, because we were fighting cold. So we were, you know, removed ourselves from the public purposely. And thankfully, we've been getting along great, and we've been practicing together. And I mean, if anything, it's made us closer, I'd say. But yeah, and then, you know, and still there's this need for connection, you know, and thankfully, there's this, you know, we have these virtual options, and, you know, all this stuff available. And, you know, and then there's still more. I want a lap cat.
I want
a little kitten that sits on my lap all day long and practices with me and meditates with me. So there's, yeah, you know, it's we haven't struggled too much with fear or confusion or anything like that. But yeah, this is what's present. Right, there's appreciation, and there's love, and there's connection, and then there's still some desire there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Gary.
Love you.
I love you too. Anybody else? Oh, actually, hang on just a second. I want to see if I can do this. There. That was when Richard Lang was with us. That's our home meeting room. What a nice place. All right, coming back. Great. Did that work? Could you see that? Yeah? Oh, good. Anybody else?
Hey, Robert, it's Doyle.
Hi, Doyle.
Hey. I was really struck when you were talking earlier about Tara working at the hospital and encountering the anger. And one of the things I've been encouraging people around is dealing with the fear. One, if you're feeling afraid, to try to mindfully acknowledge that if you're in a situation where that's coming up real strongly and wanting to express itself through anger, if we could pause for a moment and say, you know, I'm really feeling scared.
Mm.
What that often does, that not necessarily always, but often to the person who we might have otherwise directed anger, it gives them a chance to tap into the compassion for us. And then likewise, when someone's yelling at us or expressing their anger, especially right now, we might just ask, are you afraid? Are you feeling fearful?
Don't give me any of that nonviolent communication stuff. I'm just
yeah.
I'm not afraid.
Yeah. I'm not afraid, I'm pissed.
Right.
Yeah.
I say that in jest, of course. That's a marvelous right. thing to try sometimes.
Right. And depending on who you're offering that to, you just might get that kind of reaction,
mm-hmm.
More anger. So then, you know, we can just offer them some silent compassion and, you know, just give them, you know, if it's within us, give them the space to blow off some of that steam.
Thank you, Doyle.
Thanks.
Anybody else?
Hi, Allison here.
Hello, Allison here.
Hi. Oh my gosh, so many emotions are flooding through me. It's so hard not to be cheerful. This morning, my husband and I were sitting next to each other on the couch and watching the Marine Sicaria program. And in the course, it's about COVID-19. And we have both been very careful and don't expect to get the virus, but you know, there's always that chance. And so we looked at each other, and after listening to what was happening on the news this morning, and said, you know, we either one of us could be in the hospital and we'd never see each other again. We would be saying goodbye at the hospital parking lot or in an ambulance or something. And it just really got to us. And so I feel, I guess I just feel like really cherishing every moment. And not just with my husband, but with my kids and his kids, just being present on our FaceTime visits, and there's a many, especially with my little granddaughter, knowing that this is part of life, death is part of life, and we can't really control it. Sometimes we do tend to be out of control. So that's a practice that I know about, but it hit me today more than ever. And I'm very grateful that in this practice, it encourages to feel the feelings instead of stuff them. I used to always stuff them. And, or I would cry because I didn't know I was crying. Now I know why I'm feelings like this, big feelings. So it's really great to be on this little retreat and sharing it with all of you on Zoom, not just on Sundays, but so many of you that I see every day at our meditations at 7 in the morning. Well, thank you so much.
There was just a posting from Doug Pullen. You want to come on and just do a cameo, Doug? Let's see. He may have been just signing off. Therese. Anybody else?
Robert? Good morning.
Michael, hi.
Hi. Hi, everyone. I just wanted to say something that for me adds some normalcy to my life, which I think is something for all of us to strive for during these unusual times. If we were meeting in person once or twice a month, I would be collecting the donations that you all provide for people that are living on the street and trying to make their way into permanent housing. And we do that at the PIMC through an organization called Transition Projects. And so this time of year is, we're coming into spring, and it's spring cleaning time. So I just wanted to encourage everyone, if you haven't already, to think about doing your spring cleaning. And while you're doing that, if you come across any items that someone living on the street might be able to use, that would be very much appreciated. Maybe you can put it in a pile. I am working on a plan now that I could collect those things, and I'll communicate once the plan is solidified. But I did want to encourage everyone to try to do some spring cleaning and see if you don't have some items that you might be able to donate for those that are living on the street. Thank you.
Thanks, Michael. Great job on that all these years. I just remembered something I wanted to announce. It just came to me this morning. I'm going to organize a talent night that we can do over Zoom. And it'll be a talent, you know, you want to share a poem or sing a song or dance a jig or whatever it is. It'll be a couple of weeks out, but we're going to have another. We had one 2 or 3 years ago, but we're going to have a PIMC Zoom talent night. Danny can tell jokes.
Yay.
Hi, Danny.
Hi. I did have a... I was thinking, I read this poem this morning, and it was particularly pertinent. It's a Billy Collins poem.
Uh-huh.
That I'd like to share with everyone.
Go.
It's called Aimless Love.
Mm-hmm.
And it's particularly the end, you'll notice, is a certain pertinence to what's going on right now. This morning as I walked along the lake shore, I fell in love with a wren, and later in the day with a mouse. The cat had dropped under the dining room table. In the shadow of an autumn evening, I fell for a seamstress, still at her machine in the tailor's window, and later for a bowl of broth, steam rising like smoke from a naval battle. This is the best kind of love, I thought, without recompense, without gifts or unkind words, without suspicion or silence on the telephone. The love of the chestnut, the jazz cat, and one hand on the wheel. No lust, no slam of the door. The love of the miniature orange tree, the clean white shirt, the hot evening shower, the highway that cuts across Florida. No waiting, no huffiness or rancor, just a twinge every now and then for the wren who had built her nest on a low branch overhanging the water, or for the dead mouse, still dressed in its light brown suit. But my heart is always propped up in a field on its tripod, ready for the next arrow. After I carried the mouse by the tail to a pile of leaves in the woods, I find myself staring at the bathroom sink, gazing down affectionately at the soap, so patient and soluble, so at home in its pale green soap dish. I could feel myself falling again as I felt it turning in my wet hands and caught the scent of lavender and stone. Aimless Love, from a very lovely book called The Poetry of Impermanence, Mindfulness, and Joy, an anthology of, very lovely anthology of Buddhist-like poetry. Anyway, the appreciation for soap particularly got me this morning. Mm-hmm. And appreciating of what's out there in the world. I'm going for walks these days and seeing the cherry blossoms all blooming in the all the nature going on. There's still great beauty in the world.
Amen to that. Thanks, Danny. Can you mute yourself, please?
Yeah.
Thanks.
I will. Hi, Robert. And Sangha, Peter McLeese here. Actually, I'm still in the forest. Somebody can see the background on my screen. Because I met my my childhood dog, Chipper. Toto from The Wizard of Oz. Couldn't quite leave him at this point. But I did want to express my gratitude because I am a leadership coach and I have clients around the country that influence a lot of people. And because of the teachings here, I've been working with my clients to institute a daily practice, which is like meditation, but I'm not calling it that. Where they are to picture in their minds the people who depend on them at work, both remotely, and I work with a lot of responders, frontline responders, police officers. Mm-hmm. And to be thinking about what are their concerns and challenges, and what do they want and hope for, and to picture themselves being the person they desire their people to be. The people desire them to be, and then commit to being that. And in doing so, to convey caring. I don't say quite love, but that's sort of implied, you know, in the workplace. And also hope in these times. So far, a lot of them are adopting the practice and starting to. So PIMC's teachings, I'm just saying, is spreading through my work through people around the country in these tough times. So thank you
for doing that. That's really good. Nice.
Robert, this is Candle.
Hi, Candle.
Can I say something?
Of course.
Good. Nice to see everyone. I just wanted to comment on Allison's vulnerability this morning. My partner and I woke up that same way a few days ago, and we mainly talked between ourselves that we would not go to the hospital, that we make sure that we have a DNR and a pulse at home, and no one calls 911, and instead we stay home and figure out how to be with each other with whichever one is sick. And then, you know, ultimately you go to hospice or something like that, depending on your age and how sick you really feel, before we would ever choose to go to the hospital, because of that fact that nobody is in the room with you, and it's not really the way you want to go if you're that sick and or that old. So I just wanted to add that reminder that we need to look at our healthcare directives and decide what we want to do with them.
Very sobering, isn't it? Very, yes. Very awakening in a way.
Yes, it is. It invites the conversation, as Asher likes to say. So, and thank you very much for being so persistent with your daily sittings and everything that has happened with the Dharma Online. It's really fabulous.
Well, thank you.
Sadhu, sadhu.
Sadhu, sadhu. Sadhu. Thanks, Kendall. So, let me see. Anybody else? We have a few more minutes.
I'll say something. Hi, Robert.
Oh, there you are. Okay. Thank you.
Two things. One is, I'm sure that, like all of us are, if we're still watching the news at all, we're overwhelmed with the constant negative. And, but that there is, as some of us I'm sure know, but I, that on the West Coast, we're really are making a lot of progress with flattening the curve, and that the efforts in Oregon and California and Washington are, my sister's ER doctor at UCSF, and she's in charge of the COVID response, and so she's been on television. And actually, when she's been interviewed, it's only been played once because she's sharing positive news, which is in the next couple of days, if they don't see the surge, they don't think they're going to see the surge.
And whoa.
Yeah. And so that, so she was on MSNBC the other day, and they play the same thing hour after hour, but she didn't reappear because what she had to report was that they had enough protective equipment and they had enough ventilators. And in two more days, if the numbers keep doing what they're doing, they're going to be able to say we can handle this. So,
wow.
So there's bits I wanted to share. And then I can put in the chat, there's an organization, I happen to work for them, but this doesn't benefit me in any way to share this, but it's an organization that works on reporting solutions to problems, on getting newspapers to report more of that. And so we're amassing stories that are about not positive responses, but effective responses. So I can share that in the chat, and anybody can just click on the link, and then you'll find there's about 100 stories now about things going on all over the world, some of them medical responses, but also how are communities responding, how are people helping each other, and it's just a nice break from the what we usually see. So I'll just stick that in the chat. I just wanted to add that.
Thank you.
Hi, Robert. Can I speak out, Joan?
Hi, Joan.
Okay, this is all very new to me, and it's all very helpful. But if you're living with someone who's not into this and who's beginning to feel strained by spending so much time together and so much time at home and missing their routine, and is also older so that he has worries about growing out and getting affected, how do you deal with that? A lot of people have said a lot of wonderful things today, but I still wonder, who else is out there that is having the same kind of, it was very good for the first 2 weeks, and now we're beginning to have strain and stress. Mm-hmm.
I think you're the only couple that's experiencing that. I'm not, certainly. Well, I guess it's a long-term relationship, and that practice of great patience and tolerance and compassion is really necessary. That when I send people home from retreat, I say to them, so you've had a marvelous time on retreat and you've learned a lot and you want to go home and convert your partner. And I suggest this: go home and share whatever you want, but as soon as their eyes glaze over, stop. And you're allowed to say once, honey, I really think meditation would be great for you and we could do it together. And then you have to stop. Because it quickly generates resistance and don't tell me what to do and that kind of thing. And that the way we convert people is by being so, more and more and more loving and compassionate. And then they want what you have. But it's also how to be compassionate with yourself in a context which is painful. And so, and then when you're kind of thrown together like now, and that really throws us back into our practice.
Absolutely. After 56 years of marriage, we're not going anywhere.
Uh-huh. Well, and there's an unpopular thing that I say, which is that long-term relationship is very disappointing. Because there are those, what is it, John Gottman calls them, anyway, we have these conflictual issues, which, oh, here's a, John Gottman is the fellow in Seattle who's done couples research for 25 years or so. And he says that the masters of marriage, the people they know who've been, they've been following for 25 years, have resolved 30% of their conflictual issues. The other 70% remain conflicted, and there's conflict and negotiation and humor, but there's this disappointment. And so how do we handle the disappointment? And it's with love. How do we love our own disappointment and the triggers that get set off in us? How do we recognize them and then maybe defuse them? And then in conflict, how do we make corrections right away? How do we de-escalate conflict, and how do we listen a little better to hear the other person's point of view? But it's so rooted for me in the practice that when I get triggered and Jennifer and I get going around, the most important thing I can do is shut up. And then go have some time by myself, take an hour by myself, and by the end of an hour of sitting, I'm sane again. So I don't know if that's any help, but...
Well, very good advice. Thank you so mm-hmm. much, and thanks so much for offering this. I'm now committed to coming by every day. Thank you.
One other thing that Gottman said, I did some trainings with him, and he said, there are not many things that I say are the truth, but this is one. Whenever one member in a couple, whenever the heart rate of one goes over 100, the only sensible thing to do is to quit right then. To take a break, because that person's flooded and the conversations never end well. So...
Remember all this.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for your question or comment. Anybody else?
Please check out the chat line, too, for more information about Gottman.
Thank you, Jim. Oops. Anybody else?
One more thing from Jim. A couple people from Seattle want to know why I'm not doing Shibashi 1 with you guys. So maybe we can work it out for next Sunday. At least the top half, the hand movements. Seated Shibashi.
Let's we'll talk.
Work on that.
Anybody else?
Robert?
Connie.
Yeah.
Hi.
Hi. I was able to chat with David after your Zoom on Friday.
Uh-huh.
And I noticed when we're in the Sangha, part of the benefit is to talk individually with people afterwards. Is that possible on this Sunday broadcast that we click chats on other people? And
sure, I can leave it running for half an hour anyway. Yeah.
Okay, so I encourage people that if you want to connect with someone individually, to just hit on the chat on their square and say hi to them after we're through with the broadcast. And I also thought of a cool thing. We could all reach our arms out for our final song and kind of, because I noticed that we're touching each other almost on the screen.
Right.
And when we do our final, we could all touch hands.
Right. And...
Oh, virtual candle.
I have a candle. We can't blow it out, but we can at least see a candle.
Okay. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you, Connie. So we have time for another couple of people, if you wish. I want Paul's frog to speak.
Hey, Robert, this is Vic here again.
Hello, Vic.
Hey, so I just wanted to share this one picture, which really affected me. I don't know if you guys can. I started sharing my screen. Can you see that?
I see it. Whoa.
So this is something that's been able to give me a sense of how fortunate I am compared to some of the other people who are experiencing the effects of this unfortunate disease here.
Mm.
So India is now in a 3-week lockdown. And it's been a particularly harsh lockdown, if you will, and all the buses and trains have stopped.
Wow.
And a lot of the migrant workers and daily workers who work in the big cities are being asked to go back to their villages. And lines, and there are huge crowds like this that are going out from the big cities carrying everything they have on their backs.
Mm.
And they have to walk a couple to a few days before they can get back to their villages.
Wow.
And so I'm trying to see if there's a credible organization that's helping these people and if there's anything that can be done to support them directly as opposed to contributing to organizations which may try to make this more of a religious or a political but it's something that kind of helps me come back to how fortunate I feel, even though now we are in the midst of something that's terrible,
right?
Because we're going through something much worse.
Yep. Thank you, Vic. And any other persons? Please, someone, if you're sitting there with something you'd like to say and you're reticent, just say it. Well, I'm to those of you on Ustream, thank you for being here. Thank you for bearing with the beginning complications. And those of you on Zoom, how wonderful to have you in my little my quote recording studio. I will be back on tomorrow morning, Monday morning, on the morning broadcast. And look forward to seeing you then. So let's join hands. I can feel it. Now, did you wash your hands before coming into this broadcast? And I said yesterday that I when I get off these Zoom calls, I always have to go wash my hands because I feel like I've been encountering a lot of people. it's a little obsessive, but it's all right, I guess. So, wait, the candle. I can't do the candle and hold hands. I'll come back to the candle. May all beings be happy. Oh, I forgot to hang on. I got to unmute you. Wait a minute. There we go. There we go. Here it comes. May all beings be happy. May all beings be happy. May all beings be happy. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. And now take a big deep breath, everyone. One, two, three, blow. There it worked, yay! Boy, the wind in this room, was just ridiculous. Happy trails, dear ones. And so I'm gonna leave this up for a little while. I'm gonna stop the recording. Stop recording. And then I'm gonna stop my video. And stop my sound. There you go, to Doyle.
Allison?
Yes, hi.
Hi. How are you doing? It's Connie.
Hi, Connie. I'm so glad that you're on. Thank you. I'm just feeling a lot of feelings today. And it's a good thing.